Good morning, students. Welcome back to online session on Programming for Problem Solving course. We were actually discussing about the program development steps. Okay, when we are writing a high level language program, what steps we generally follow in an organization? I mean, when we try to solve the given problem using a high level language, before writing the program in high level language, what sort of steps we need to follow, that we were discussing. We are calling them as program development steps, and in that few of them we have already discussed, like the understanding the problem, the first step. I have given the idea about it. Then developing the solution, in that structure chart we have already discussed, algorithm also we have completed. Now we were discussing about the pseudocode. In this session, if possible, I will give the complete idea about the pseudocode, because the discussion we had in our previous session only about the pseudocode. Today we'll discuss some of the examples with respect to this pseudocode, and then we'll see the flow chart, what exactly a flow chart. Okay, after that we'll go for writing the program and testing the program as well. Okay, so quickly, so all these things we discussed, the examples of algorithms and the pseudocode, the advantages, the definition, everything we have discussed in our previous session, so I'm not repeating that again. So this also I told you, I mean I have explained you, I mean when you have the code, C code, without the knowledge of C language, for you it is very difficult to understand. Okay, the code, whatever I have written over here, the code you will not understand basically. But when you see, when you read the pseudo code about that code, okay, whatever code I have written over here, the respective pseudo code I have written in the right hand side. Okay, the left hand side, the C code is I'm having the C code, and the right hand side I'm having the pseudo code, which is giving the description, which is giving the information about this C code. Okay, so when you are reading this pseudo code, you are understanding what this code exactly does, isn't it? If I is less than 10, increment I value by 1, I am saying. So whenever I value is less than 10, immediately what we are doing, we are incrementing I value by 1. Okay, whenever you are processing this piece of code, and whenever you are checking this condition, if I value goes less than 10, immediately increment I value by 1. Okay. This is exactly the meaning of this code. Okay, so pseudocode examples, I mean whatever examples we have seen for the algorithms, those same examples will try to write the pseudocodes. Okay, so the first one, design a pseudocode to add, subtract, multiply, divide, and to find the remainder of two numbers and display the result. Same thing we have done with the help of algorithms, and now we do with the pseudocode. I mean, we'll write the pseudocode for the same problem statements. Okay, so quickly you see, previously we made many, we discussed in such a way that we are not making the algorithm as a standardized approach. But even though we said in every algorithm we need to have the starting point and we need to have the end point, and every step in the algorithm, it must have a proper numbering, so that a person processing the algorithm must know which step he has to do first and which step he has to do next, isn't it? But in pseudocode, we don't have any such thing. No starting point, no stop point, and no numbering to the statements, nothing. And even we try to minimize the mathematical notations as much as possible. Okay, so over here you can see the first statement, what I'm writing, this program will allow the user to add two numbers. So by reading this statement only, such kind of thing is not there in the algorithm. For what purpose we are writing the algorithm, we are not mentioning, isn't it? We are simply writing the step for the solution, but for what purpose we are writing that solution, we have not mentioned anywhere in the algorithm. But when you see the pseudocode, the first line itself describes the purpose of writing the pseudocode. Okay, the purpose of writing the program. Hope you understood. So here I wrote, this program will allow the user to add two numbers. So basically what this pseudocode or what this program, whatever we are writing or whatever we are about to write, will do in the sense, it will add two numbers, okay? It will add two numbers and print the result. So as a first thing, what we are doing after making that description, we are declaring the memory locations, okay? Declare the memory locations, num1, num2 and sum. This is same like in your algorithm. Then read values for num1, num2, same like your algorithm. Then add num1 and num2 and assign the result to sum. So this thing we mentioned over there with the help of a mathematical notation. We simply said sum equals to num1 plus num2. But here we are giving the description about that statement as well. Add num1 and num2 and assign the result to sum. And moreover, whenever we are assigning the result to a particular memory location or to a particular variable, we are not using the assignment operator. We are using the arrow mark. It is a notation, the arrow mark. By seeing the arrow mark, one can understand where the value is going, from which point to which point, what is the source and what is the destination. In that way, he can easily understand. Because if we use the assignment operator, there is a confusion whether we are assigning the value or whether we are comparing the value. Because in many different languages or even in your mathematics, whenever we use this equals to symbol, it represents the equivalency. It doesn't represent the assignment, isn't it? It doesn't represent the assignment, rather it represents the equivalency. So over here, to avoid that confusion of using the assignment operator, we are using the arrow mark. So this arrow mark, it simply says, or it simply represents that we are adding num1 value with num2 value, and we are storing that result inside sum. And after storing the result inside sum, the sum will hold the result, and that result we are printing with the help of a print statement. So print the value of sum on the output screen. So everything more precisely we are giving, more specifically we are giving, isn't it? That's the purpose of writing the pseudocode. Okay, to make the code or to make the idea more clear than the algorithm, we are using pseudocode. Remember this one. That is the basic use, or that is one of the advantage of writing the pseudocode in our program development process. Hope you understood. So quickly, so here we have already done the addition. You can easily change this pseudocode to find the subtraction, that is minus, then multiplication, then division, then modulo division, because our task was to find all those things. How to do the addition, I have already shown, the subtraction, multiplication, division, and modulo division. Okay, finding the division and to find the remainder of two number, that is nothing but modulo division. Remainder in the sense, modulo division. Okay, all these things you have to do in your running notes. Wherever you are recording the important points from my video, in that notes only you have to do all these things. Okay, rest of the things, both for algorithm as well as this pseudocode. Write the algorithm for the rest of the things, because we have written only for add, isn't it? And write the pseudocode for rest of the things, as we are doing only addition here. Okay, hopefully you understood. So the next thing, design a pseudocode to calculate the interest of a bank deposit, PTR by 100. Amount, years, rate of interest divided by 100. Okay, so for that same thing we are writing the pseudocode. So again, the first statement in the, the first description in the pseudocode, it will tell the purpose of writing the program. So this program will allow the user to calculate the interest for a bank deposit. Okay, so by reading this statement, one can understand the purpose of writing the pseudocode or purpose of writing the program. Okay, so then what we have to do, immediately we have to declare the variables or declare the memory locations. Okay, one such memory location is amount, then year, then rate of interest. Three we are declaring. Sorry, rate and interest. Okay, two separate variables. This is one variable and this is another variable. Okay, so overall four variables we are declaring: amount, year, Okay, rate, then the last one, the fourth one is interest. Likewise, we are declaring four variables. Now, read values for, we read the values only for the first three. We read the values, value for amount, we read the value for year, and we read the value for rate. But we don't read the value for interest because we calculate the interest. Okay, so over here, yes, as we already mature enough to understand the equal operation, so you can either use the equal or you can use the assignment. This is arrow mark. Okay, so calculate the interest with formulae, interest arrow mark, amount multiplied with years multiplied with rate divided by 100. That entire thing, how I dictated just now, you can write in that way or you can directly put the complete formulae between the double quotes. Okay, between the double quotes, and calculate the interest with formulae. When you mention this formulae, the reading person will understand that it is a banking formulae or it is some formulae that he don't know. Okay, so he simply copy whatever you kept between the double quotations, he simply copy that thing as it is into the program or as it is in his understanding. Hopefully you understood. So either you try to describe, or either you try to describe this whole thing in your words, or you can put as it is, I mean you can put that stuff as it is and put that thing between the double quotations and make it as understandable, like call it as a formulae or call it as a calculation, like that, so that the reading party can understand this is something beyond their knowledge. So they will not try to go into that. They will simply copy that thing as it is. Hopefully you understood. So then, after calculating the interest, because here we are calculating the interest using this formulae, so once the interest is calculated, we need to print that interest onto the output screen. So that same thing we are doing over here. Print the value of interest on the output screen. So in this way, we can write the pseudocode for calculating the interest of a bank deposit, for a bank deposit. So the next thing, yes, we need to check whether the room temperature or the current temperature is below the freezing point or above the freezing point. So for that, we have already written the algorithm. We are going for the pseudocode now. So here you can read, this program will allow the user to determine whether the temperature is below or above the freezing point. So what we have to do, we need only one variable, that is temperature variable. We need to read the temperature, so we need to declare the temperature, then read temperature value. So here, yeah, if temperature value is lesser than 32, because 32 is the freezing point, if temperature value is lesser than 32, print a message, temperature is below freezing point. So whenever the temperature value is below 32, that is nothing but lesser than 32, we are printing a message that temperature is below the freezing point. Okay, otherwise what we are doing, if this condition is not true, if the temperature value is not lesser than 32, then what we are doing? We are printing a message that temperature is above the freezing point. Very simple. When you read this entire thing, you're understanding the solution and you're understanding the algorithm as well. Okay. To convey, we said the purpose of writing the pseudocode is to convey the algorithm. Okay. If there is something which you are not understanding inside the algorithm, then by reading the pseudocode, you can easily understand. Okay. So the next thing, the problem statement number 4. So design a pseudocode to find the biggest in two numbers. So again, we'll read two numbers, we'll do the comparison between those two numbers, and whatever condition we are framing, if that condition is true, we'll take the decision accordingly, and if that condition is false, we'll take the decision accordingly. So quickly go and see the pseudocode. So here, this program will allow the user to find the biggest in two numbers. Okay, so we are finding the biggest number in two numbers. So how many numbers we need to declare? Two numbers, because we need to read two numbers. So declare two numbers like num1, num2. We are declaring. Then read values for num1, num2. We are reading values for num1 as well as num2. Then if num1 value, okay, we are doing the comparison here. If num1 value is greater than num2 value, if num1 value is greater than num2 value like this. If num1 value is greater than num2 value, then what we are doing? We are printing a message that num1 is greater or num1 is big. Okay, we are printing a message num1 is big. Likewise. Otherwise, what we are doing? Otherwise means what? Over here. Else or otherwise means what? We are this condition is failing. Whenever you say otherwise or whenever you say else over here, that means this condition is failing. If this condition fails, then immediately we have to make num2 as big, isn't it? So that same message we are printing over here. If this condition is failing, print a message that num2 is big. So in this way, we find out the biggest in two numbers. Okay, so the next pseudocode, design a pseudocode to determine whether a student passed in the examination or not. Again, we read 6 subject marks. So based on this 6 subject marks, we'll calculate the average. And if at all average is greater than 60, we conclude it as pass. Okay, the student is pass. If it is not true, if the average is not greater than 60%, if this is false, then we conclude it as fail. Okay, we conclude it as fail. Or you can go with opposite as well. If at all average is less than 60%, then mark him as fail. Or if at all this condition is true, we'll go with this. If at all this condition is false, we make him as pass. Read that condition first. Average below 60, we are saying. Average below 60, if this is true, we need to fail that student, isn't it? If average below 60 is false, okay, if average below 60 is false, that means average is greater than 60, isn't it? In that case, what we have to do? We need to pass that student, likewise. So quickly go and see the pseudocode. Yes, this program will allow the user to determine whether a student passed in the examination or not by considering 6 different course marks. Okay, 6 different course marks or 6 different subject marks we are considering. So how many variables we need to declare? Because after considering the 6 subject marks, we are calculating the average also. So total 7 variables we need to declare. 6 to read the marks and 1 for calculating the average. Okay, so 6 subject marks, how we are reading? M1, M2, M4, M3, this is M4, M5 and M6. 6 subject marks we are reading. We are going to read into these memory locations. Then we calculate average or grade. Both are same. Average or grade. See, variable name, memory name, whatever you take, you have to maintain a uniformity within the program. Okay, it is up to your wish whether you take here as AVG or whether you take here as grade. But once you have declared a particular name over here, inside your program or throughout the program, try to maintain the same name. Don't change the name afterwards. Okay, so here as we are maintaining grade, as we have declared grade, I will try to use grade only. Okay, so then read the values for 5 subject marks, that is six subject marks, M1 to M6. Then calculate the average, that is grade, with formulae. Again, we are saying formulae over here. Okay, with formulae, because to describe this entire thing, whatever we are doing over here, in terms of regular natural language statement, it is very difficult. So that's the reason I wrote that complete thing as it is, and I told the other parties to copy the stuff as it is. If they don't understand, let them like that only. Because sometimes explaining formulas, it is not possible. Okay, so let them be with this formulae. Let them copy this formulae as it is in their programming. So what we said, grade equals to this entire thing divided by 6. So you will get the grade over here, average grade over here. So if grade value is greater than 60, we are saying greater than. If grade value is greater than 60, print a message pass. Okay. Otherwise, fail. Otherwise means what? If the grade value is lesser than 60, then we need to fail the student. So the same thing we are doing over here. Then the next one, design a pseudocode to find the given number is even or odd. We need to check whether the given number is even or odd. How we conclude whether the given number is even or odd, in the sense, we will divide that number with 2 and we'll check the remainder. If the remainder is 0, we make that number as, we conclude that number as even number. And if the remainder is 1, we conclude that number as odd number. So this thing you have to remember. So same thing we are doing. Already we did this in algorithm. Now we are doing in pseudocode. So this program will allow the user to find the given number is even or odd. So what is the purpose? We have written over here. Then how many variables? Only one variable is enough. This remainder is not required. Or yes, remainder is required over here. Okay, remainder is required. So num comma remainder. Two variables we are declaring. So read the value for num. We are reading the value for num. Then calculate the remainder by using the formulae. Again, we are using formulae over here. What formulae? Remainder equals to num divided, modulo divided by 2. So whatever remainder it will return, whatever remainder you will get when you perform this division with 2, that remainder will be stored inside this remainder variable. Okay. So now, if the remainder equals to 0, if this remainder variable is equals to 0, print a message that number is even. Whatever number you are reading over here, that number is even. Otherwise, print a message, number is odd. Likewise. Simple understanding. Simple understanding we need over here. Okay. So based on the remainder value, we are concluding our statement. Okay. We are concluding our statement. If the remainder is equals to 0, make the number as even. If the remainder is equals to odd, then make the number as, if the remainder is equals to 1, then make the number as odd. So with this, we have concluded the pseudocode concept. We discussed all the examples as well inside pseudocode. Let me just check the time. It is 21 minutes, so still we have more time. So we'll go with the flowcharting now. So what is flowchart in the sense? See, there is a saying in English that a picture will say more than 1,000 words. So whatever problem solution you have in your mind, when you try to convey that solution to a third person or to a different person who is responsible for writing the program, it will take more effort if you try to explain the solution orally, isn't it? If you try to explain the solution orally, it will take more time. That's the reason we have all these steps. We have the algorithm, we have structure chart, we have pseudocode, and finally the flowchart. So this flowchart, it is considered as one of the efficient way of conveying the message, okay, or conveying the idea. The flowcharting is one of the efficient way. Why it is efficient in the sense, every single step in the flowchart or every single step in our logic processing, we will represent with the help of pictures, with the help of different symbols. Okay, with the help of a diagram, what I mean to say, with the help of a flow diagram. Okay, so when you see a diagram, a picture, let us say I have visited some location. Let us assume that I have visited the Taj Mahal. And assume yourself as you have never seen the Taj Mahal in your entire life, not even in the picture, not even in a movie, not even in a picture. Let us assume some foreign friend. Okay, I have a foreign friend. He don't know about Taj Mahal anything. So I have I need to explain the stuff about the Taj Mahal, how it was built and how it is looking, everything, the scenery, the weather over there, the environment over there, the decorations, the gardens, everything. I need to explain to my friend, to my foreign friend. So if I start explaining that stuff orally to him, so it will take a lot of time, isn't it? I need to say that it is having 4 minarets, it is having one dome on top, okay, and it is completely constructed with the help of marble, and we have nice gardens over there, we have fountains over there. Like this, I need to give more explanation to him. So rather than giving this explanation, if I show him the picture of that Taj Mahal, he will understand it very easily, isn't it? He will he will get the idea that it is having 4 minarets, it is having one dome, and it is completely constructed with marble, and it is having gardens surrounded it, it is having some fountains over there, everything, every single idea he will get from that picture. So instead of giving the verbal description or instead of writing the description on a paper and showing it to the programmer, if we go with a diagram, if we go with a picture, he will get some clear picture of the idea. Isn't it? He will get some clear picture of the idea. So that's the reason there is a saying in English that a picture is more than 1,000 words. A picture is more than 1,000 words. So because we need to give the clear idea about what solution we are having in our mind to the programmer so that he will develop that code using a programming language. So they thought that writing the algorithm, writing the pseudo code, writing the structure chart, developing the structure chart, these things are not sufficient. There is more required in order to convey the idea clearly. Sir, that requirement is nothing but our flow chart. So what exactly a flow chart? If you read the definition over here, the first point, flow chart is a program design tool in which standard graphical symbols are used to represent the logical flow of data through a function or through the program. So when we are saying the function, that function is nothing but through our program only. So generally what it will do, what we are doing inside that, it is a designing tool, first of all. It is a designing tool, and whatever symbols we are going to use inside the designing of a flow chart, all they are some standardized symbols. You are not taking any symbol of our interest, any symbol of our desire. We are making use of all these standardized symbols only. So whatever symbols we are going to use, whatever designing modules we are going to use when we are designing the flowchart, all those modules, they are standardized. All those what we call graphical symbols, they are standardized. Standardized in the sense, throughout the world, they have to use the same symbol when they are drawing the flowchart. So if you have the knowledge of those symbols, by seeing the symbol only, you can tell what exactly the user wants over there. Okay, by seeing that symbol only, I can say what type of operation I'm performing over there and what exactly the user is wanting me to implement. Okay, so flowchart is a program design tool in which standard graphical symbols are used to represent the logical flow of data through a function. A flowchart is used to show the logic flow of a program. Okay, it is a pictorial representation of an algorithm. So whatever description we have written, whatever steps of description we have written inside the algorithm, that steps will show with the help of a picture. And that picture is nothing but your flowchart. So it is a pictorial representation of a algorithm. Remember this one. It is very, very important because many times, even in your external Viva, they will ask this thing, what exactly is a flow chart? Okay, so you have to remember that algorithm, whatever we are writing like steps, that steps we represent with the help of a picture. That picture is nothing but your flow chart. A flow chart is nothing but it is a pictorial representation of an algorithm. Remember this one. The primary purpose of a flowchart is to show the design of an algorithm. Graphical symbols are used to show the design. Okay. So, quickly, flowchart can be used to design either the complete program or a part of the program. Such parts can be called as functions in C language. It is not necessary that you need to design the complete program at once. Okay, the complete logic processing for the solution at once. So you can subdivide the complete, we already told you now, the divide and conquer rule, it is the best approach to solve any kind of given problem. Okay, so in that way, in that approach only, what they will do, they will divide the big complex problem into some number of modules. Okay, where each module will become easy to conquer, easy to develop the solution. Okay, so flowchart, it can be used either to design the complete program or to design a part of the program. So such parts, Such modules, we call them as functions in C language. So, your flowchart, it can be used to design the complete program or it can be used to design the functions as well. Okay. When using flowcharts, programmers are free from programming language syntax. So, because they are using complete symbols over here, they're not doing any what we call programming stuff. They're not bothering about the compiler of generating errors. So, they are free from that programming language syntax. So, they can focus more on the logic. Okay. They can focus more on the problem to be solved. Instead of thinking about the programming syntax, programming language syntax, if I write a statement, a particular statement like this, do my compiler is going to raise errors. Such kind of fear is going to be there in our heart and mind when we are developing the, when we are writing the program. So instead of going directly to the program, what we are doing, we are writing algorithm, we are writing pseudocode, we are drawing a flowchart, because all these things are free from the compiler. So we can, whatever we want to do, we can do with a relaxed mind. Okay, so that we can focus more on the problem solution to be developed. Okay, so to design a flowchart, the following symbols can be used. So we said, in a flowchart, we are going to have all graphical symbols, and those graphical symbols are standardized symbols. They are not rough symbols, or they are not the idea of any particular person. Okay, they are universal. They are agreed upon the programming computational environment or programming world. They are standardized. Okay, so to design a flowchart, the following symbols can be used. They are auxiliary symbols and primary symbols. Only two symbols, auxiliary and primary. So the term auxiliary, if you know the meaning of this term, you can easily remember all the symbols. Auxiliary means supportive. They are not becoming the part. Okay. They're not going to becoming the part. Okay. So sometimes, when, let us assume if there is a game going on boxing. Okay, boxing game is going on. Okay, so there will be in that boxing game, there will be rounds, isn't it? We are going to have round 1, round 2, round 3. Before the knockout, we are going to have different rounds. Okay, based on the result of those rounds, the umpires or the referees, what they will do? They will announce the winner, isn't it? So when two players are playing this boxing game, there are some other people. In both the teams, there are some other people waiting outside the ring. Isn't it? They will wait outside the ring, and after every round, what they will have? The two players get separated and they will join their team. So what the team will do, they will give some ideas. Isn't it? How to play that boxing game, what are the weak points of the opponents, what they have observed during this fight, they will give that loopholes to the actual team member, isn't it? Active team member, we can say, who is going to play the game. So in that way, all these teammates, what they are doing, they are giving support from the back. They are standing out and they are giving the support to the actual player. So those players, we can call them as auxiliary players, because they are not participating, rather they are giving support. So here, when we are saying auxiliary symbols, they are a part of your flowchart, but they are not going to do any kind of thing in your flowchart. They are not going to do any kind of thing in your flowchart. Any kind of processing they will not do. They will just, we are using these auxiliary symbols just for the decoration purpose. Of course, they are having some clear meaning inside the flowchart, but they will not take any kind of processing thing. Remember this one. Auxiliary symbols and primary symbols, when we are saying, auxiliary symbols are the supportive symbols and primary symbols are the active symbols. Like only one person is playing the boxing game over there. So he is the primary player. And the people who are standing behind and giving the support, we can call them as auxiliary players. Hope you understood this one. So the first one, auxiliary symbols. So what exactly, what symbols we are calling them as auxiliary symbols in the sense? See, just read this first point and whatever explanation I have given in my previous slide, you will understand over here. So read this first slide. So I just want to check the time. It is almost 35 minutes. So still 10 more minutes we have. So we'll try to complete these auxiliary symbols and the primary symbols we left for our next, we leave for our next session. Okay. So the primary symbols and then the examples. Okay. All these things, many things we have still in flowcharts. Okay. So the auxiliary symbols. So as you read the first point, these symbols, they enhance the readability or functionality of the flowchart. They do not show any instructions or commands inside the flowchart. Their purpose is very simple over here. They are not going to carry any instruction, any command inside your flowchart. They will stand behind and they will give the support. That means these symbols are used to enhance the readability or enhance the functionality of your flowchart. Okay, they are used basically. I mean, in my understanding, I'm telling you, you remember these auxiliary symbols, they are used for decoration purpose. So without these auxiliary symbols, your flowchart is not complete. Your flowchart is not complete. So how many different symbols we have inside these auxiliary symbols in the sense, three types. Okay, we have three different types of auxiliary symbols. I have given some names over here, numbers over here, A, B and C. So the first one, A, that is terminal symbol. If you want to see that symbol, how it looks like, so it is like an oval shape. We call this as an oval shape. So it is a terminal. Then we have the flow lines. Just see the flow lines. Okay. Flow lines. Okay. Connecting. These flow lines, they are helpful. We read the actual purpose of this auxiliary symbols in our upcoming slides. So just remember, the terminal will make like an oval. Okay. And flow lines are nothing but arrow marks pointing in all the directions. If you want to point down, this arrow mark you can use. Point towards top, you can use this arrow mark. Left and right, you can use these two arrow marks. Okay, right, left, likewise. So all these different arrow marks pointing in different directions, we call them as flow lines. Remember this one, we call them as flow lines. Then we have another one, that is connector. Okay, the last auxiliary symbol, that is connector. The purpose of using this connector we'll study in our next slide. So the symbol, if you see, it is a circle. Inside it, we need to put number. Okay. This N stands for the numbering. Okay. We can take like this, circle 1, circle 2, circle 3, likewise. So N represents, generally N represents, inside this circle, N represents a number. So this is a connector. So terminal, flow lines and connector. Three different things we have, three different auxiliary symbols we have to that these can be used in our flowchart. So the first one, the terminal symbol, okay, the terminal symbol, the oval symbol is used to represent a terminal. The first point you read, the oval shaped symbol. So this is like this, oval shaped symbol is used to represent the terminal. It is show, generally why we use this terminal in the sense, to show the beginning as well as the ending of an algorithm. See, when we wrote the algorithm, I have shown you that the first statement or the first step in the algorithm is the starting of the algorithm, and the last step in the algorithm is the stopping of the algorithm. So when you are representing the algorithm with the help of a flow chart, so the beginning we show with the help of a terminal, and ending also we show with the help of a terminal. So when you are using the terminal to show the beginning, you make a label inside it like start. So how we can show means, take the oval shape and put start label inside that. Okay. Put, I'm not an artist over here. So, okay. So like this, you have to understand. Okay. So simply take the oval shape and put the start label inside it. So then to show the stop, ending of the algorithm, take another oval shape and put stop inside it, S-T-O-P. Or, so I said, the flowchart, it can be used to represent two things. One, the entire program, and the other one, a small function, a small module. So if it is representing the entire program, then it is going to have start and in between different symbols and then the stop, if it is representing the entire program. But if it is representing the small module, then this module can have the starting point, but that is not the end point, isn't it? We cannot end the module. So we have to return from the module. So if it is a small module, we use a different end symbol, that is return symbol. Okay. So if you are implementing the complete program, the conclude the program with stop symbol, conclude the flowchart with stop symbol. But if you are implementing only the small piece of the program, then conclude the flowchart with return symbol. Okay. Module we are concluding with return symbol, but the entire program or entire flowchart, the main flowchart, we are concluding with stop symbol. Very soon you will understand how we are implementing modules and how we are implementing the complete program with the help of flowchart, and how these stop terminal and the return terminal are going to help us in doing so. Okay, the basic rule of structural programming is every algorithm should have only one entry point. Okay, when we are talking about an algorithm, it should have only one entry point and it should have only one exit point. So there will be only one start terminal and there will be only one stop terminal in every flowchart. Remember this one. And the shape of the terminal, the name of the symbol, everything I have given over here. Okay, so this is about terminal. Next thing is the flow lines are the why we use these flow lines, in the sense for connection purpose. Flow lines are used to connect different symbols. In your flowchart, we are going to have different symbols. To represent every step from your algorithm, we are going to use a different type of symbol inside the flowchart. So when you are writing some, when you are drawing some different types of flow, different types of symbols inside the flowchart, you need to show the flow of those symbols. I mean, from which symbol you have to go to which symbol. So such type of connectivity we show with the help of these flow lines. So flow lines are used to connect different symbols inside the flowchart. They also shows the order or sequence of these symbols. So which symbol should come first and which symbol should come next. The ordering of those symbols, it will also be shown by the flow lines only. Okay, every symbol in a flowchart will have some entry point and some exit lines. Okay, like whenever you are going to a particular symbol inside the flowchart, so before that, after the start symbol, definitely you need to have some arrow mark pointing towards that symbol, the symbol which you are currently processing. And after processing that symbol, again you need to go to a different symbol or you need to go to the stop terminal, isn't it? So every symbol inside the flowchart, it should have some entry point and it should have some exit point. Remember this one. So for example, start oval will have only one exiting point. There is no entry point to the start oval. There is no entry point to the start oval because the start itself is the starting point. So if it is the starting point, it is not going to have any entry point, isn't it? Then there is no exit point for the stop terminal because stop itself the end point, and after stop we are not going to have anything. So there should not be any exit line from the stop. Okay, there should not be any entry line to the start and there should not be any exit line to the stop. Okay, next thing, we have the connectors, and after this I will conclude the lecture because it is almost 45 minutes. So connectors, so in our next session we'll discuss the primary symbols. So a connector, I have already shown the symbol, it is a circle, and in that circle we'll put a number, isn't it? We'll put a number inside a circle. So we are going to use this connectors in two different cases. Okay, so if I show you the example, yes, over here you can understand. Okay, so the connector is nothing but inside a circle we'll put the number. Okay, we'll put the number. So this is how we represent a connector inside our flowchart. When you are drawing the flowchart, this is how you will draw the connector. And the connector, it is having two different purposes. So this is the first purpose and this is the second purpose. Okay. So what are these purposes in the sense? The first purpose, see, suppose if you are drawing a flow chart, you have started the drawing of a flow chart and you reached the end of the page. Because our pages, A4 size pages, they are having limited space, isn't it? Like suppose this is my A4 page, let us understand from here to here my A4 page. Okay, so from here I started my flow chart. So I'm drawing different symbols inside my flow chart, terminal, then like this symbol, I'm drawing all these symbols and I reached end of the page. So I reached end of the page and still my flow chart is not complete. So what I have to do, I have to start the flow chart. I mean, where I am ending in the first page, I am going to start the same flow chart. I mean, the remaining flow chart inside another page, isn't it? Inside the second page, let us assume. So inside second page when you are starting and inside first page when you are ending, at both the places you have to put these connectors. So these connectors, because there may be a confusion. If the flow chart is going more than 3-4 pages, let us assume that it is going up to 3-4 pages. So which page has to come after which page? Okay, so we'll put numbering on the pages, isn't it? This is something like that only. So we'll conclude the first page with connector 1 and then we'll start immediately in the next page, we'll start the flowchart with the same number. So that we'll consider this one and this one as the connecting point, for the flowchart. So this is the first purpose. And there is another purpose inside your flowchart, okay? Inside your flowchart, when you are using different control structures, basically this type of situation arises when we are going to use the control structures, because control structures only going to have blocks. Block is nothing but it is a collection of statements, combination of statements. So inside a control structure in your flowchart, it will become difficult to put all the statements. Okay? To put all the statements. So what we do in the sense, we'll mark the connectors over there. We'll mark the connectors over there and we'll draw that particular part separately on a different page. Okay? We'll draw that particular part separately on a big size page. Because over here, the space is very limited. Because this entire thing, whatever I have drawn over here, from this point to this point, it is a control structure. It is a looping statement. Okay, when you understand all the symbols clearly, you will understand this as a, this diamond shape as a looping symbol. So whenever you have a looping symbol inside a loop, if you want to put some 100 statements or 10 statements and this state, this particular space over here, it is not sufficient to push or it is not sufficient to put all those statements. Okay, it is not sufficient to draw all those statements. So what we do, we'll make the connectors over there and we'll draw these statements separately on a different page. And in the beginning of that separated flowchart, we'll put the connector, whatever we have started over here. And at the end of that separated flowchart, we'll put the connector, whatever we have ended over here. Okay, so this thing, this particular connection will give the idea. Okay, we have separated this flowchart on a separate page. You can refer, I mean, whatever existing over here, whatever statement you want to consider over here, for these things, you can refer the connector, you can refer the shapes between 2-3 connectors. You can refer the shapes between 2-3 connectors which have drawn on a separate page. So likewise, these connectors are going to help us. Whenever you reach the end of the page, we'll make the connector over there, and on a separate page, we'll make the same connector so as to have the continuity. Okay, and whenever it will become difficult for us to put different shapes or different symbols in some squeezed area, so in that case also, what we do, we'll take the help of connectors and we'll put all the symbols which you want to put in that area on a separate page. Hopefully you understood the purpose of connectors, and with more clarity you will get the understanding when we actually do this flow chart, okay, when we actually draw this flow chart. So that drawing of flow chart we have to do after the discussion of primary symbols. So one more session on this flow charting, and after that we will get into the further concepts. Hopefully you understood. Thank you very much, students.